I'm Ann Pasternak. I'm the Shelby White and Leon Levy Director of the Brooklyn Museum. And on behalf of our board and the entire Brooklyn Museum family, welcome to the 7th Fund for African American Art Gala, honoring the one and only, the extraordinary, the exceptional Pamela Joyner. Did you know that for nearly 100 years, the Brooklyn Museum has had a commitment to showing the work of great African-American artists? It's true. We mounted such important monographic exhibitions, including 2 Jacob Lawrence shows in 1960 and 1987, shows in the 70s by James Van Der See, Romare Bearden, and nearly 20 years ago, Carrie James Marshall. We have had the honor of working with such great contemporary artists as Kehinde Wiley and Lorna Simpson and Wangechi Mutu and Micheline Thomas. We have curated scholarly, groundbreaking, and influential group exhibitions such as Witness, Art and Civil Rights in the 1960s. And I am proud to share that in just a few weeks, we will be opening the first major museum show of African-American women artists from the 1960s to mid-80s called We Wanted a Revolution, Black Radical Women. You'll all get special invitations for that too, and the books. For the past 7 years, thanks to a group of truly committed and visionary women, and I'm gonna ask them to stand, Tracy Reese, Charlene Goins, and Sandra Cornwall. What are you doing back there? Charlene, I'm sorry I asked you to stand. Because of these 3 women, we were able to go beyond exhibitions and build what we hope will be one of the seminal collections of African-American pre-contemporary art. Because of their vision and their hard work and all of your support, including the involvement of our former Andrew Mellon Curator of American Art, Terry Carbone, and her predecessor, Linda Farber, because of them and all of you, we have been able to represent the depth of African-American artistic practice over the course of 2 centuries more fully and permanently than I believe any other New York museum. And this is also possible largely because each year we have a wonderful, deserving, amazing honoree. And this year, we all know, we're here to celebrate Pamela Joyner. Can't clap enough. When in business school at Harvard, Pamela met our mutual friend and an honoree at the museum this past fall, the one and only Lowry Stokes Sims, who was then curator at the Met. Through Lowry, Pamela was exposed to the work of great African-American artists. She was struck by their formidable challenges and saw them as, quote, pioneers with real grit and courage. And indeed, they were, and they are. She was moved by their plight to assert their creative right to be seen and heard. And so, with her husband, Alfred Giafrida, Pamela was motivated to collect their work, not just for their own pleasure, but to share with the world their passionate belief in these artists and that their stories are our stories. They have assembled, without question, an extraordinary collection of modern and contemporary art that celebrates legends as well as emerging artists of Africa and the African diaspora over the past 100 years. Artists who defied limitations, artists who defied social conventions, artists who defied prejudice, artists who defied isolation, and artists who were insistent in telling our truths. Their collection shares the struggles of civil rights, equal rights, and the passion to overcome great obstacles. It is a collection that tells the story of triumph against all odds with dignity and beauty. It's a collection based on necessity and urgency and the hope that society may be transformed as a more empathetic, just, and equal society through this art. Personal transformation, social transformation, that is what great art does. It is, we hope, what the Brooklyn Museum does. And for sure, it is the radical work of Pamela Joyner. Tonight, inspired by her vision, we have asked some of our artist friends who have been a big part of Pamela's life to respond to their predecessors, those great pioneering African-American artists who are represented in the Brooklyn Museum collection. I am pleased to share that the four artists we love, Simone Leigh, Hugo McCloud, Julie Mehretu, and Jack Whitten, will join us shortly on stage, along with the talented curator, Rujeko Hockley, who has sadly left the Brooklyn Museum, but is we're very proud of her being at the Whitney. Welcome back, Ru. But first, it is my pleasure to introduce our new Mellon curator of American art, Kim Orcutt, to tell you a little bit about some of our recent acquisitions. Kim.
Well, thanks, Anne, very much. It's a privilege to help celebrate the amazing work that's been done over the past several years to bring the finest examples of African-American art into the museum's collection and into the conversation about the history of American art. With all of your help, we've recently purchased one of the finest examples I've seen of the work of Edward Mitchell Bannister. Thank you, and there he is. The most important African-American landscape painter of the late 19th century. Bannister was born and raised in Canada, where slavery had been abolished. In 1850, he established himself as one of the first African-American artists in Boston, where he was active in the thriving abolitionist community. After the Civil War, he moved to Rhode Island, where he became a cultural leader. Banner won a medal at the 1876 Centennial Exhibition in Philadelphia, making him the first African-American painter to receive a national award. He also helped found the Providence Art Club in 1878, which became the model for the Rhode Island School of Design. This Rhode Island landscape is a large and significant mid-career painting that shows the influence of the French Barbizon style that was warmly embraced in New England. And the painting also shows its past. You can see that the varnish has become a little yellow, and if you looked really carefully, you might find a tear in the upper right that maybe needs some repair. And our talented conservators will be working on this painting in the coming months to restore it to its original glory, and we're very much looking forward to its debut in the galleries. Your example of support for the fund has inspired some wonderful gifts as well, and I want to thank them tonight. Charlene and Warren Goins for a Charles E. Porter still life and a Robert S. Duncanson landscape that you'll be seeing a little later. Peg Alston for a Charles Alston painting. Milton and Nancy Washington for a Grafton Tyler Brown Yosemite landscape. Jason Wright, who got us started on Bannister with a gift of 5 pastels. And they're light sensitive, so we can't display them as often as we would like, but you'll see one of them on the screen tonight. Ian Fuller gave a Norman Lewis watercolor. Audlin Higgins Williams and E.T. Williams Jr. donated a Hale Woodruff watercolor. Camille and Luther Clark presented a library collection on African American art. And last but not least, we are grateful to all of you, the donors to the fund. And now I have the pleasure of introducing our moderator for tonight's program, our dear, dear former colleague, Rujeko Hockley. She is assistant curator at the Whitney Museum of American Art. Previously, she was assistant curator of contemporary art here at the Brooklyn Museum, where she worked on a number of acclaimed exhibitions, some imaginatively drawn from the collection, and others focusing on artists such as Latoya Ruby Frazier, the Bruce High Quality Foundation, Kara Walker, and Kehinde Wiley. And we look forward to seeing her work as co-curator of the much-anticipated forthcoming exhibition that Anne mentioned, We Wanted a Revolution, Black Radical Women, 1965 to 85. Please join me in welcoming Ru.
Thank you so much for being here, and thank you to Anne and to Kim and to everybody who's organized this event, and obviously to the fund, the many beautiful and wonderful, brilliant people that worked on this, and Pamela. There you are. Thank you for coming all the way from San Francisco during a snowstorm. So we're going to get started, and I'm just going to tell you a little bit about our program for tonight. We wanted to bring the fund, which as you just heard, is pre-1945 works of art, together with the present. All artists were contemporary artists once, at the time that they made the work, obviously. And so we wanted to bring four of our, you know, most brilliant artists of our time up on the stage. Also people who Pamela has worked with, who are featured in her collection, some of whom live in Brooklyn, so, you know, we have that going. So we're going to kind of have a rapid-fire conversation, myself and, to start with, Hugo McCloud right here. And then we have Simone Leigh, Julie Mehretu, and Jack Whitten. So this is a really wonderful group of artists, and we're really kind of blessed and very lucky to have them. So thank you in advance. Thank you, Hugo, for coming on stage with me first. And let's see if I can figure this out. Okay, Hugo McCloud. So very quickly, Hugo McCloud works primarily in abstraction, large-scale, beautiful works. He recently had a wonderful show at Sean Kelly Gallery, which I hope you saw, and if not, he'll tell us what else he's up to, so you can find him later. But we're gonna get started, because, you know, time is of the essence. So, we asked each artist to select a work that was brought into the collection through the fund over the last, you know, several years that it's been existent. So Hugo chose this beautiful painting by Buford Delaney, entitled Fang, Crow, and Fruit from 1945. So the first thing I wanted to ask you, Hugo, is why did you pick this? What drew you to this work or to this artist?
Yeah, I was drawn more to the artist rather than the work. Because as I was reading more on Buford, I really started to see that I identified with him, that he also struggled with identity within his work, and identity as well within his life. And I think it's interesting as an artist, sorry, I'm a little nervous, but I usually get much better in time.
He's so doing great though, right?
I think he was interesting as an artist because he didn't identify himself in a particular manner. He was in abstraction, he was in modernist work, he did still life, he did portraiture, and it related much to my practice as well, because I felt he was an artist that was continually searching as an artist, and he didn't want to be identified as something particular. You know, like they say that he started abstraction before abstraction took off, but he didn't really want to be part of that movement as well. And I think that it's an interesting place to be, because I feel like as an artist, we come into being an artist because we want to be free. And I feel like he continually wanted to be free within his practice to explore these different ideas. So that was very interesting to me. As well as there was also another interesting point of his personal life. And that was that though he respected he respected the black art movement, he didn't want to be identified as a black artist or as a Negro artist, as he would say.
In that period in which he was active, yeah.
And I very much relate to that practice as well. I'm an abstract artist. I deal with materials. I deal with subject matter. But I'm an artist. And that's how I want to be identified as. So, you know, through the reading of that and also understanding of where he came from Tennessee and, like, the upbringing that he came from, his mother was born into slavery, you know, he has a reason to identify with so many of these things, but he chose not to, and I found that to be very interesting.
Okay, thank you. And for some background, as you can probably see from the slide, he's an artist who's born in 1900, lives through kind of three quarters of the 20th century. Very active in this piece is from 1945, but active during the Harlem Renaissance, but was more kind of closely associated with the village. So I think to your point, this kind of desire to differentiate himself on his own terms is something that we see frequently in many, you know, all artists, but particularly African-American artists, perhaps, who are sometimes saddled with something they're not interested in. So I think that kind of freedom to choose and that freedom to work in whichever way that you choose is something that we can see in Delaney. And of course, you know, a beautiful still life in general and the influence of African art, which you can see with the Fang object, the statue. So this kind of merging, what, you know, the Alan Locke, kind of the new Negro, this kind of moment in the 1920s, 30s, 40s. So in general, Hugo, I'm curious about, does art history generally influence your practice pre-1945 or otherwise? How do you see yourself in a lineage in regards to any artist, in regards to the past generally?
I can't say that it directly influences my practice, to be completely honest. I think everything that we see as an artist, everything that we put our eyes upon that somebody has done in the past, it makes us question what we're doing in our own practice. So as I come upon this, and then as I research him and start to see, you know, when he started to dive into abstraction, when he was doing portraiture, when he was doing still life, a lot of these things that he was doing back in the 1940s, then it can definitely relate to my practice now, because I see myself as well diving into all of these different areas. You know, I'm doing a series of portraitures right now that actually deals with Black identity, you know, and it deals with the
Tell us more.
The portraitures that I'm doing is our self-portraits of myself, and the title of the whole body of work is Being Black, Black Enough. And it's the question that I have, you know, is being Black a Black artist, is that Black enough? Like, why do I have to do anything else? So, it's something that I battle within myself. You know, I come from a very, I come from a mixed background. Something as well that relates to me with Buford is that, you know, he came up in Tennessee, and there was written history about him and his brother and how they were always hands-on making stuff as kids. And I remember stories from my father, who grew up in Houston, Texas during segregation, about him and his brother, how they would race home. Like, my whole family on my father's side are all artisans as well, and how they would race home to make something. But they weren't necessarily making anything for commerce. You know, it wasn't for sale. It was the act of creating. So I think, you know, to come full circle again, to come back to the whole thing, like, I think that as I'm educating myself, because I as well come from an academic side of art history, I didn't go to school, so like as I'm coming upon these artists and these times, as I research them, they definitely then relate to my work, because then I can see, like, well, this makes sense of why I'm practicing this, and this makes sense in how it relates to the history of art.
Wonderful. Well, I'm going to redirect us a little bit, because we are here to talk about Pamela a little bit, and I know that she has collected your work, so I just wanted you to speak a little bit about kind of who is Pamela to you, and what kind of influence or impact do you feel that she's had in your work, in your career, et cetera?
Well, I think my first connection with Pamela was through an email. And she emailed me and asked, I believe she can come to the studio. I believe that was correct. And this was four studios ago. So she came to that studio, which was behind a cafe at the time. And, you know, and now I'm in a completely different studio, and she's always been there. She's always been very well connected to what I'm doing. Very hands-on, very informative. But I think the biggest thing about Pamela that I always found, and I found it, you know, to be honest, with very few people within our world, is that you can shoot really straight with Pamela. And I think that is very valuable to somebody that you can really talk straight to about what you're dealing with as an artist. You know, because I feel as an artist, like, you're going through a lot of things, and as you grow as an artist, within this art world, you're faced with a lot of things and a lot of decisions that you have to make. And a lot of times you don't really know how to make the best decision. And you need somebody that you can really trust that doesn't have any incentive to take anything, you know, doesn't have any incentive to sway you any type of way. And she's always been that person that you can really shoot it to you straight, and you always get a, you know, an honest answer from her. And that's something I personally have valued from my relationship from her.
Wonderful. So I think that we're actually going to leave it right there, because that was such a lovely tribute.
You're
to Pamela.
With me?
Well, okay, no, tell me more. Sorry. You told me you wanted to get off the stage. Okay, very quickly then. You're working on this portraiture series. Where can we see it? Do you have things coming up? How can we find you, Hugo? What do you have going on?
I mean, this is actually one of my galleries right there, and she doesn't even know about this body of work. So, it's actually...
Sneak peek.
No, but you know, I think that's something that actually really related to me about Buford, is that, you know, if you come into my studio right now, I'm working on a portraiture series. I'm working on about five different bodies of work all at the same time. You know, some stuff that I've been doing that are continuations of bodies, and then, you know, I dive into other things or I get an idea. And the portraiture series is something that I wanted to start a long time ago. And it was really with that title, Is Being Black Black Enough? Mm-hmm. Because it's always been a question as an African-American abstract artist, mm-hmm. where is the identity of my work?
Yeah.
You know, where does it come from? And does it need to have that? And, you know, it's always been one of those things because I'm half Austrian as well. It was like, why does it have to have that subject matter to it? Mm-hmm. You know, this is the work. It's left for you to read. So, you know, hopefully it's a body of work that actually comes out to being something promising. Right now it's a bunch of black on white. That's about all I can tell you. But I find it interesting. Nonetheless, that's what being an artist is. You know, it's exploring these ideas that you have. If it comes to nothing, then who cares? It's not the point of anything else besides just making art.
Okay, well, wonderful, Hugo. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Yes.
Thank you, Pamela.
So in our rapid fire method, I will now welcome the great Simone Leigh to the stage.
How are you?
I'm wonderful. Thank you for being with us tonight. It's really wonderful for me to be sitting with Simone, who is an artist that I've known for a while but admired for much longer. And I'm sure many of you know her beautiful work. Recently, it was at the New Museum, Black Women Artists for Black Lives Matter. Simone has been incredibly instrumental in that group, and they are now doing a project at Project Row Houses in Houston, coming up very soon, yes?
Yeah.
Okay. So she's very busy, so we're very lucky to have her here, and I really appreciate you being here. And Simone also lives, like, you could throw a stone to her house from the Brooklyn Museum, so that's very special. We are surrounded by artists here. So Simone selected a beautiful sculpture by an artist named Nancy Elizabeth Prophet, who also, like Buford Delaney, was born, well, she was born even earlier in 1890, but, you know, these are people who were around in the earlier half of the 20th century. Untitled Head came into the collection. It's a beautiful piece. It's on view right now. I should have mentioned that, actually. So is, I believe, the Buford Delaney. So please go see them on the fifth floor after this. But so, Simone, we're going to do a kind of similar process. Can you tell us a little bit about this piece? What drew you to it? What drew you to the artist? And again, I should have said with Hugo, you know, this can be affinity or it can be perhaps not the opposite. But, you know, sometimes we're drawn to things that we don't quite like. Just putting it out there. But go ahead.
I have always thought of Nancy Elizabeth Prophet as part of a triad of artists, including Edmonia Lewis and Augusta Savage. And one of the things that's true about all of these women is that there is not that much work available. So for me, it's just almost like, you know, a meteor to like have her work here in the museum. Yeah. It's actually quite significant to just be able to be next to these pieces. So, but when I talked to you about doing this talk for Pamela, I started doing some research on her career, and I happened upon her diary.
Okay.
Which is startling and changed my life.
Oh, well, look. Fun for African-American art event changed Simone Leigh's life, so we have that going for us.
And I'm not exaggerating, because I'm writing a talk for RISD, and she was the first African-American artist at RISD, mm-hmm. and she did not have the support of her family, so she paid for that by working as a domestic the entire time. Mm-hmm. And then she made her way to France because she could not compete or deal with the various forms of racism she was dealing with here. And she worked, and she starved, and she worked, and she starved, and she wrote this amazing diary. Mm-hmm. And so I wanted to read some
Please,
of those pieces
yes.
because it you know, a lot of it feels like she could have written it last week.
And while you just find the section, I just want to say very quickly that, yes, as Simone said, very little of Prophet's work survives, and so it is incredibly poignant. And when you see this piece, it is an incredibly poignant piece, I find, just even to look at it. And so there is something about, yes, this kind of commitment to being an artist kind of above and beyond all.
Yeah, no matter what. So this is about a day after she's arrived. So this is 4 pages into a 50-page diary.
And what year is she writing this?
It's in the 1922. Mm-hmm. Out of pure weakness, I wrote to my husband to come over. This was a very stupid mistake on my part. He being a good man, but completely helpless, without ambition, without hope, character, personality, and of a fearful nature. That was a read.
Yes!
I couldn't believe that she wrote this. And it goes on and on. And then she says, as soon as I could stand up, I went to work, sick, but with a dogged deliberation to conquer. I worked away on my first piece of sculpture with a calm assurance and savage pleasure of revenge. This is the way she talks. And I really loved the way she posits sculpture as revenge. Mm-hmm. And so for the past few weeks, I've been thinking about that. I mean, as a revenge against, you know, whatever forms of racism she was encountering, or and just thinking about this process of making sculptures, being able to really, that she's actually literally rewriting her subjectivity back into history, you know. And also the thing that I think is important about Elizabeth Prophet, I mean, there's even some moments in this diary where she talks about the way it felt to swing like clay in her arm and throw it up on the stand. And she literally worked her way into the hospital several times from starvation. She talks about her pants falling off of her body as she was working. Mm-hmm. And she doesn't talk about it with pleasure, but there's an obvious pride that mm-hmm. she has in her accomplishments. And I'm just really thrilled, you know, that I was able to find this diary.
Was the diary published? Where exactly did you find it? And how
there's
does it
an
exist
archive,
in the world?
In Providence, in this particular 50 pages at Brown. Mm-hmm. And it's online. I can send you the link.
Sounds like it's
even the handwriting is interesting. I'm just lost in this thing. It's so exciting. She just had a full life, despite all these things. She went to Spelman and started a sculpture program there and taught for 10 years. So I'm just thrilled that this piece is here, and I'm glad that you asked me to do this, because I would not have found this diary. And
that's so wonderful.
It means so
Simone.
Much to me. And I even thought that the way she talks about work and the way she conceives of what sculpture means and how it relates to her own body, mm-hmm. and these moments of exhilaration as she doesn't have food, foregrounded Adrian Piper's Food of the Spirit, mm-hmm. Where she also fasts and
this
recites Kant.
This is a piece from the 1970s, so a very different period by a very different artist, but where she fasted for a period as kind of an exercise in both kind of philosophy. She was a student of philosophy during her doctorate at Harvard, but also as a conceptual art practice, so documenting kind of maybe every day, I'm not sure how often, but documenting kind of her body kind of as a
there's something
wasted
like
away a little bit.
Phenomenological about exactly. both of the processes, yeah. And so I felt like I just found a treasure, so thank you.
Thank you to the fund, honestly. Thank you, and thank you to the museum for acquiring that work. That's really, to me, like, this is exactly why this program, all of us being here and you four artists being here especially, I thought was such an important way to kind of honor Pamela as well as the fund, and to think about kind of art history, our predecessors in the field. So generally speaking, Simone, in your work, do you look to art history? Is that something that's been an influence in your life as an artist over the last however many decades, generally speaking? Who are your heroes?
I have a lot of heroes. I think the most important hero is Anonymous. There's so many women that didn't make it into the archive. So I'm always thinking about her. I don't know. It's hard to know where to begin when I think about who I've been influenced recently, like artists like Lorraine O'Grady, mm-hmm. who's going to be in your show. Who I've even had the opportunity to collaborate with, and she's especially her writing has been a huge influence on my work.
Her work is on view in the Egyptian galleries. You can go see it afterwards as well.
I would say that these narratives, I mean, the other thing that's interesting about this diary is it reminds me of Octavia Butler's like writing. I don't know if you saw that page that someone found where she said that
from her own diaries,
and she said, "I will be a best-selling novelist, and I will." And I just think it's so interesting, and it's similar to some of the pieces that were here at the Sackler Center that Lorraine Hansberry wrote. Mm-hmm. And looking at these different, you know, biographical fragments of these different, what's interesting to me is throughout there's a kind of tenacity and fierceness and aware that this level of confidence is what's necessary to accomplish the task. And so I've been very inspired by that.
Well, that's incredibly inspiring. Thank you, Simone. So I think actually I feel like we should leave it there because this tenacity and this heart is so much, I mean, it is, I think it's at the heart, as we learned earlier about Pamela's collecting. It is kind of, nobody does anything without having a real kind of core, steely kind of core in the heart of it to keep you going, both over time, but also at those moments of indecision, moments of confusion, moments of doubt, or just moments of it being very hard. And so I think like that is so much about, I think sometimes what is missed about being an artist, that if you work with artists, you know so deeply that you guys work incredibly hard and you are incredibly tenacious. And museums, when we work with artists, we see that and we know that. So yeah, thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, next in our lineup is the brilliant Julie Mehretu. I feel like a talk show host. This is amazing. I'm like very, very comfortable with this introduction in and out. So Julie is also, this is a blessing all around for me to be up here with these four artists. In particular, Julie is one of the first artists that I knew of as a contemporary artist. I don't know if you know that. My first job was at the Studio Museum in Harlem, and I worked on an exhibition called Frequency, and Julie had been in Freestyle, which was the kind of precursor, the first F show out of four. And a very influential one. This was in 2001. Julie has done 1 million amazing things since then, including, you know, be a U.S. Medal of the Arts honoree only just last year, or May 2015, 2 years ago. So, yes, it is really lovely to be here with you. So Julie selected this work, a beautiful painting by Robert Selden Duncanson, Dream of Arcadia, after Thomas Cole. And so this work is from 1852, so now we're kind of moving back even further from our first two works. So Julie, we'll talk a little bit more about the context, but tell us, what drew you to this work?
I mean, who's not like blown away that this work is painted by an African-American artist in 1852? And to me, just, I have my own kind of fascination with Hudson River Valley School painters right now for a project I'm working on, but I was really, when you think of Hudson River Valley or Hudson River School paintings, mm-hmm. and you think of what the project is in retrospect, how we understand that project of painting, and it's kind of the reading of that in terms of the American colonial project and the manifest destiny and the expansionist project of the American kind of imagination and the effort to somehow capture the sublime and the awe of this landscape and possibility, which at the same time is a landscape that is inevitably that the flip side of that sublime is the colonial sublime.
Of course.
You know, the kind of intense violence and fear that's kind of implicit in that awe, in a sense, but also in that project. And so for me, like, I mean, I look at painting, I study painting constantly, but this, to see this painting, especially when I was looking at a lot of other, and Thomas Cole, and to see this painting after Thomas Cole, being painted by an artist who's living in, or at the time, my understanding, and I'm not sure if this was painted in Cincinnati, but my understanding is that he was living there, right?
Yeah, he spent a lot of his life in Cincinnati, so I'm also not sure, but we can,
and then he went to upstate New York. So he was painting in this context, but with an intention of being part of this conversation, studying Poussin, who I study, studying, what's his name? Lorraine, Claude Lorraine, and this type of landscape painting.
Thank you, Terry.
Yeah, and this type of, and then studying this, but studying through, like, engravings, and studying through the only way that he could. But this
Because unable to see the originals.
Yeah, unable to see the original. And but being in this city that was this fervent kind of abolitionist city, but also very close to this slave state, slave-like, you know, Kentucky, and also being on a frontier city of this expansionist project, and being in the midst of that, and choosing, like, becoming one of the finest landscape painters of his generation, like working at this craft, this was this language, and this project that he was involved in and indebted in, and there's an intense kind of contradiction that I see in looking back at that. And I was just talking earlier with Sam, like trying to make sense of how, and it's in my interest in looking at these kind of paintings, in the touch of these paintings, in the effort of trying to, what this, there's no way to avoid a political in this image and philosophy.
Can you say a little bit more about that?
Well, just how you're thinking about it's called, Dream of Arcadia. There's this idea of this transcendental idea of philosophical idea of engagement and humanity. And this is an artist working in a moment of, this is when slavery is legal. This is when the Civil War took place. Painting was made before the 13th Amendment. This is when this landscape was like impossibly connected with and couldn't be disconnected from the violence of disallowing humanity to the black body or to that. So to me, that was the language to then use to try to like insist on humanity, insist on self kind of intent.
Autonomy.
Level, yeah. That's what it kind of like, it blew me away. So.
Yeah, well, and the Hudson River School is so interesting because of, as you said, this relationship to manifest destiny, the kind of sublime landscape, and this kind of the vastness of America, this being such a huge amount part of the American identity and psyche, but also this art history, the School of Art History. But meanwhile, you know, indigenous people lived in these places, and many Hudson River School paintings you'll see, you know, like the tiny, you know, indigenous person, because the scale.
And but his paintings, too.
Yes, and these ones, too, exactly. And then Arcadia.
Or black bodies that, you know, and it's complicated. And to me, that is so fascinating. And the contradictions inherent in that, that are constant. And so part of me is also, why can't I look at it without imposing the political of who he was. But Thomas Cole's project is implicit in terms of what that project of we understand this entire school of painting to be. But at the same time, there's this other dialogue of having to prove your worth as a painter, as an artist, as in kind of owning this language. And to me, that's that other drive of insisting on themselves and being there, and that insistence on this capability. And it goes back to looking at those earlier, just the
previous works.
The previous works, and both artists, actually.
Something that I just occurred to me, actually, Julie, as we're talking. So you work in abstraction, but there's a very much kind of topographical, geographical landscape element to a lot of the work that you make. And I'm curious if you can just talk very quickly about kind of this is what we think of when we think of landscape painting. But I've heard your paintings discussed as landscape paintings. Couldn't be more different. So I'm curious, you know, in 2 minutes or less, I think it's interesting.
But
so
right now I'm working on these two very big paintings for San Francisco, for SF MoMA, for the lobby. And one of the ways that I was trying to locate them there is by actually looking at Hudson River Valley paintings and Thomas Cole and Bierstadt painting, and inverting them, actually reducing them to an 8-bit pixelized kind of map of this landscape. But because of the violence that's implicit in this landscape for me, that the internal side or the flip side of that sublime and that gaze and that what was kind of tried to be described in a sense of like this being in awe of just not this landscape but this project and what the cost and what the bigger kind of desire of that project could be, and then to find this really in the midst of that project was kind of really, it made me rethink everything again within that. And those contradictions are what's so fascinating about this creative project or art, or you know, and Pamela's like how you support the possibility of that other imagination and in terms of our moment. And
tell us a little bit about how Pamela, your relationship to Pamela, and kind of
Pamela is the kind of heroine and advocate of the resistance. Like you are the the marker of making and seriously for decades, putting together this amount of work that's not erased or becomes hidden figures, as a lot of this work that we're talking about has become. And that this is not part of the history of Hudson River Valley painting that we study, but that this has becomes this aside. And what you've done with your collection to the many artists from Sam Gilliams, Norman Lewis, and many others that were so, where I didn't know of these artists, I had to come to them later, and they're part of the language, part of our conversation now because of the work that you've done and the collections you've put together and putting that on the map, including the work all of you do to maintain
that. Yes, including
that.
The work that all of us do, absolutely. Yeah. Well, thank you, Julie.
This
is perfect. Okay, and now I am happy to introduce my final conversationalist, a person who honestly needs no introduction, the great, great, great Jack Whitten. And Jack has a beautiful show that's up at Hauser & Wirth Gallery in Chelsea right now, so please go see it. It is stunning. And so Jack chose not one, but two beautiful works that came in through the fund. So the first is Norman Lewis's Untitled from 1944. This is a work on paper. And so, Jack, I'm going to tell you guys what the second one is first, just so you know. This is the beautiful Edward Mitchell Bannister pastel from 1885 that was mentioned previously. So how did you come to your selections?
Yeah, let's start here first.
Oh, perfect.
Introduction to the previous painting. The word sublime is not to be taken for granted. It is one of the most powerful symbols we have in the history of art. There are only a few symbols available to the artist to investigate. The sublime is just one of them. We have technology. We have nature as a whole. Even fashion. There are references that has remained a constant throughout the history of art, and artists react to these symbols. What's amazing about this piece, now it's a pastel on paper, it's not a glorified oil on canvas, which we tend to place more emphasis upon.
Yes.
But it must be said that It's the artist's works on paper, if you really want to see the evidence of soul in the artist. It's the paper. Before it gets to the paint on canvas. What's significant about this? We have to go back into history. For a black person to even contemplate the notion of the sublime at that time in history refuted everything that white people had to say about black people. This was an act of, we speak of activism and so forth, but activism comes in many different colors, many different avenues to act. For a black man at that time to even contemplate the notion of the sublime, this is what's so revolutionary. Now, them ain't just trees you're looking at. Let's go a little further, then we'll go to the Dolores.
No, go. We're following you.
The sublime can come from anywhere. In truth, I see it every morning when I walk out of my house in Jackson Heights. Every morning I see it. Quite often, throughout the history of art, nature has been the prime mover in the search for the divine. But in the morning when I hit the street on the way to the studio, every day of the week, I look down at a little toddler that might be 6 months old, 1 month old, 1 year old, and they look up at me like, it's the sublime. For human nature to recognize the fact of the sublime makes us human. I don't give a fuck what nobody else has to say.
We can clap for that.
And this is what's significant about the piece. It's immediate. It's nothing fancy. It's extremely dry bean pastel. It absorbs the light. It's not glossy. It doesn't reflect a lot of light and a lot of sequins and this and that. It's basic human stuff. That's what makes it important. In connection to that whole period, another thing we have to speak of about this piece, and this artist in particular, you have to remember, Tanner's was born much later. Henry Osawa Tanner.
Tanner, yeah.
Tanner knew this. Mm-hmm. He knew both
of them.
He knew
these works, yeah.
He knew Duncanson. He studied it. The point that I make here is, within the black community of artists, there is a continuity that is recognizable, definitively recognizable.
Absolutely.
And it's about time that all of us start paying attention to it.
Absolutely. And Henry Osawa Tanner, for those of you who don't know, was considered kind of the first successful, very well-known African-American artist. And I think this point about a lineage is so
absolutely
important. Both.
We have to acknowledge this. We have to acknowledge this. Let's move to the Lewis. I know we don't have much time.
Okay. And so this is, as I said, from 1944. So we're leaping ahead about 50 years.
1944, it's untitled, but let's get real here. These are poker players. It's a card game. And it's not a game. They're playing for money. One of the things I used to ask Norman when I first met him, Norman, how in the hell does somebody make a living out of this stuff? And Norman would look at me with those big eyes and he would say, yeah, you know, I make a few bucks playing poker. I go to the racetrack all the time. Now, I'm not saying this as a demeaning factor. I'm telling you, the man was a gambler. He played in the poker dens up in Harlem, late night poker dens. That guy on the right there, see the figure on the right? He's losing his shirt. The man is like anxiety. The figure in the center, he's holding the card. For damn sure, the guy on the right is Norman. He's cool as a cucumber. He's gonna take the money and he's gonna walk out of that joint, hey. It's also interesting to note that if we were to compare this to a previous card game, let's go back to Cézanne, the card players, much earlier, Norman knew the painting. One thing about Norman Lewis, he knew the history of painting inside out. You could discuss any language with him in terms of art history, and he knew. He was fully aware of the Cézanne card players. If you were to put the two of these together as subject matter, a very good lesson comes out. We have a good lesson in sensibility. Very different from the Cézanne. Mm-hmm. This thing is very fluid, very open, shifting planes. In truth, when I look at this piece, I have a word for it. I call it shifting psychological tectonics. Planes are constantly shifting. Legacy of Norman Lewis that exists today. Part of that continuity is why I'm sitting here today. Mm-hmm. That's where it's at. Now we move to Pamela. We have to start with the larger picture. The larger picture is the art world. We use the word quite often, we see it written, but we don't stop to think what it is. What is the art world? It's a big interconnected octopus. That's what it is.
An octopus?
Yes.
Okay.
I like octopus, I hunt them. I like to eat octopus. That's why I use the word octopus as metaphor. We have the museums. We have the director of the museums. We have the trustees of the museums. We have the curators of the museums, first tier. Then we have the galleries. We have the director of the galleries and the workers in the galleries, whose primary job is to promote the artist's work and hopefully, not hopefully, we better make damn sure that they sell it. That's the gallery. We have the publications, the art history books. We have the editors of art magazines. Lo and behold, we have the collectors, the supporters. This is where Pamela comes in. She represents a part of this so-called art world that we in the Black community have not had before. This is where she comes in. To have somebody in that position, and I don't mind saying it, I don't mind clapping my hands when I say it, the woman is Black. We haven't had this before. It should be a signal to every Black person in society with financial means. Do any of you know how much money is wasted in the Black community? Have you ever thought of that? Have you ever thought of how much money is wasted in the Black community? This woman does not waste the money. She's doing something with it. She's part of that continuity. We need 1,000 of Pamelas. That's what we need to make a difference.
Absolutely. I couldn't agree more. And so I think that honestly, so this is, I want to bring it right back full circle because I think that's so much of what we are actually doing here and what the fund has been doing over these past several years is trying to create an army of Pamelas, and they are already also, the three of you, Sandra, Charlene, and Tracy, you are in that lineage, and this is why we're honoring Pamela this year. So yes, I think that is such a wonderful place for us to end, and I'm gonna ask Jack for you to stay on the stage because I believe we have another thing that's about to happen. I'm not exactly sure what it is. But first of all, I'm just going to say thank you so much. Thank you for being
thank
here.
You.
And
thank you.
Really quickly, I just wanted to say very quickly that if you have not seen or would like to see, because you love it so much, a work by Jack Whitten, We have one on view here at the museum. Oh, no, wait, we don't. It's gone. I'm sorry. This is what happens when you're transitioning. But in any case, it's a beautiful work in the Brooklyn Museum's collection, Black Monolith, and we're so grateful to you for making it, for having it here on view for so long. So thank you again, and let's go on to the next part.
I am very excited to welcome to the stage last year's honorees, Charlin and Warren Goins, who are going to present the award and introduce Pamela. And before I do, I want to say that this is one of those moments where you say, I'm really glad I was here. This was incredibly breathtaking evening, and I'm so grateful to all the artists and to you, Rue, for sharing so deeply and so beautifully your thoughts about these works and about life and about art. So thank you. I was verklempt the whole time. Okay. Charlin, please come join us, and Warren.
Pamela, all of us who are involved at the Fund for African American Art are so very grateful to you for agreeing to be our honoree, for orchestrating this fabulous public program, but most importantly, for your support of African American artists, your book, all the things that you've done that have brought African American artists to the world and not just to our small group. You have just done incredible work, and we are so very grateful. Thank you. We do have. Yeah, please. We do have just a. We have a small token of something. He can hold it for you because it's heavy.
It is heavy.
But it's just a token of our gratitude for
you
doing
so much.
This.
Thank you so much.
And if you would. If you would say a few words, please.
This is a moment of for thank yous. I have to thank Ann Pasternak and her wonderful team here at the Brooklyn Museum, along with her trustees, for putting together not only this wonderful evening, but for being stewards of a globally recognized and really forward-thinking collection that has embraced inclusiveness long before it was popular. I have to thank the four artists who spoke this evening. I'm really lucky. I get to wake up every morning and look at works by Simone and Julie and Hugh and Jack, and I am inspired. That's mostly in part because I have no talent of my own. But these are people and these are objects that remind me and us of our own humanity and the ties which bind us, which are much more important than those ties that separate us. And so in our collecting, we're attempting to be activist. I really, Simone, like this notion of dogged determination. For those of you who know me, I got sort of a little dose of that. And so what we really are hoping to do is to prevent the erasure that Julie referred to and to make certain that great talent, and it's, I mean, in a way it's easy because all of these people are talented in, you know, the ultimate way. So all I have to do and all people like me who love this art have to do is shine a light on excellence. And that's what we're endeavoring to do. And we're endeavoring to do it in a way that permanently etches the work into the full arc of the full art historical canon. So thank you for participating.